plans, and we'll see how it goes along. So it's not a talk which intends to be complete in any way. It's just a talk which shows some very important points and some important pointers in managing these patients with end-stage renal disease. So I'll just take up two patients, and we'll analyze the cases. Then we'll see when to initiate dialysis. We'll talk a bit about the IDEAL trial. And finally, we'll talk about modality selection, all in the next 20 minutes. Okay, so we have the first patient, who is a 46-year-old lady. She's a known case of renal calculus disease, history of bilateral calculi. She had mild renal dysfunction but has no records of the same. I see her for the very first time in an emergency, and she has history of 8 years of disease but not a single report with her. Now she comes symptomatic for 10 days and she has fever along with decreased urine output and breathlessness. She also was having recurrent breath, vomitings. When she came, she already had visited 3 separate hospitals in the time being and then had come to me. Okay, when we see her for the very first time, we see that she's having borderline low blood pressures. She has generalized anasarca, Krebs are present. She has advanced azotemia along with acidosis, marked leukocytosis, severe anemia. We initiate her on dialysis with a triple lumen dialysis catheter. And in the meantime, we get an imaging which shows that she has a very small right kidney and a left kidney which is grossly hydronephrotic with a lowered ureteric calculi. So we get a urology consult and we plan that the intervention will be deferred till the patient is stabilized. So after 3 days, we give her 2 sessions of dialysis and 3 units of blood transfusion. And she has marked symptomatic improvement. In the meantime, a DJ stent is placed by our urologist and it shows drainage of frank pus. At this point, like it's 3 days, she has come to a rather expensive hospital, so she requires to be referred to other centers. So she goes to PGI-MER after being discharged on referral. But I see her again after 3 months. And after 3 months, she comes exactly the same scenario as before. And what I find out is that she had been declared to have end-stage renal disease when she visited PGI Chandigarh. And there they had worked her up for 1 month. They found that she had no drop in her creatinine values. They had advised her dialysis, regular dialysis. However, she was doing just irregular dialysis. In the meantime, she had received multiple antibiotics. No definitive procedure was done. The stent was still in situ. She presented with sepsis, advanced azotemia. Again, we took the help of our urologist. And in the meantime, we kept her on dialysis. She was using the same catheter that we had put 3 months back. So she had come back. We removed the catheter. We put a new line. And in the meantime, DJ stent was removed. And an AV fistula was attempted. However, unfortunately, the AV fistula could not be made in spite of 2 attempts. So a permanent catheter, a permacath, so to call, a tunneled catheter, was placed for dialysis. At this point, again, she was discharged. And however, she presented again after 2 months. This time, she presented with catheter-related bloodstream infection, high-grade fevers. There was history that someone had attempted a DJ stent once again. And in the meantime, due to maybe some procedural complications, she had developed intra-abdominal clots and exudative ascites. She was very sick, so we told her that maybe she will require an exploratory laparotomy. They were not willing for the same, so we discharged the patient. This was the first case. Now, in like complete distinction to that case, let's look at the second patient. The second patient is a 68-year-old male. He's a known case of diabetes for the last 20 years, he's hypertensive for 12 years, he had had CABG 4 years back, he has proliferative diabetic retinopathy, all complications of diabetes, and he had mild renal dysfunction. He presented with complete heart block, and after presentation with complete heart block, he required a TPI insertion. During that period, he developed an acute AKI on top of CKD and required 2 sessions of dialysis. However, he gradually came off dialysis, he remained off, like he was having a creatinine of 4, 4.5, he had other complications of CKD. In the meantime, we discussed the modality of RRT. We discussed whether he would go about PD or hemodialysis. He had no donors in the family and they were not willing for transplant. So gradually over the next 3 months, there was gradual rise in creatinine to 5. He was still asymptomatic. In the meantime, he had decided, okay, I'll go for hemodialysis. So AV fistula was made, a left distal AV fistula was made. 2 months later, the creatinine was rising gradually. It came to 7. There was edema of the limb in which the fistula was made. However, the fistula had not developed and he was asymptomatic otherwise. Then what had to be done was the fistula basically had developed some branches. The branches were tied off and a good fistula segment was available. Serum creatinine gradually came up to 8. He had no symptoms, but he decided, no, I won't wait. I'll just go ahead with dialysis. So he was initiated on twice weekly dialysis. He was taking all his medications regularly. And 2 years from then, he's still on dialysis. He's receiving 3 times weekly dialysis, and he's doing quite well currently. So basically, we see a marked difference in the profile, and we'll see how exactly it goes about. So we'll just begin with a few basic slides. We all know this slide. This is basically showing the different stages of chronic kidney disease based on GFR. Please remember to calculate GFR in every person. This is something we talk about all the time. 15 minutes? Okay. So basically, I just wanted to show you in this slide the creatinine level, let's say, of a 40-year-old male with weight of 65 kg. We see with increasing creatinine values, what happens is the rate of loss of GFR is much less, but the rise is much higher. So this is to basically tell you that a rise of creatinine of 1 to 2 is a drop of GFR of 45, whereas a rise from 6 to 7 is just a very minimal drop from 15 to 12. So this is just taking the Cockcroft-Gault phenomena formula. Also, let's say a patient has creatinine of 1.5. We very frequently tell, okay, this is the creatinine. But these are two persons, same creatinine, 1.5. One person, 100 kgs of weight, 6 feet in height, age 30 years. He will have a GFR of 105 with a creatinine of 1.5. Whereas that is Lady Elizabeth, close to 100 years of age. And she, if she has a creatinine of 1.5, will have a GFR of just 15. This is just to emphasize that we need to go, get the creatinines done, and along with that, calculate the GFR in every patient. So what is end-stage renal disease? It is basically when the stage of kidney disease is such that it is not sufficient to maintain life as a whole. So we require renal replacement therapy. That is the indication for definition of end-stage renal disease. Usually persons will have GFRs less than 15. Only then they will usually require dialysis. There are three options: hemodialysis, peritoneal dialysis, and renal transplantation. So again, we come to the lady. What went wrong? So lots of things went wrong. First of all, she had mild renal dysfunction. However, they really neglected it. She did not follow up. So we'll see, follow-up is required at least 4 times a year in CKD5, but it is at least once a year, even in lesser stages of disease. Secondly, we have some surgery for renal calculus disease. They didn't maintain the records as well. And finally, this is another thing that happens. They keep visiting separate hospitals, maybe because they are poor, they tend to visit many places, and they lose precious time. So this is the frequency of follow-up in patients. We see that around once a year is required in most renal dysfunctions, but up to 4 times a year when the patients progress to CKD stage 5. Indications of dialysis, I'll not go into this because all of you know it. It's severe metabolic acidosis, hyperkalemia, pericarditis, and cephalopathy. So we'll just continue with the same case. So again, what had happened? This patient had volume overload. This patient had acidosis. These two were the indications that we begin dialysis in her. So again, what went wrong? Once we initiated dialysis, we had to initiate dialysis through a temporary catheter. This has been shown to adversely affect the prognosis. Second, we had to do blood transfusions. Kindly avoid blood transfusions in all patients of end-stage renal disease, because transplant happens to be the best treatment, and there are just 3 sensitizing events for transplant to have an adverse outcome. That's a pregnancy, a previous transplant, and blood transfusions. So blood transfusions are to be avoided. Then, again, after discharge, she was just receiving follow-up. She was receiving just once weekly or irregular dialysis. Persons with regular dialysis do much better, whereas she was just receiving dialysis once a week. No definitive procedure was done. Nothing was planned. That is another thing that went really wrong with this. So, and these temporary catheters, they are to be kept for 1 month at the most. But she was on the catheter for the same 3 months. That is the other reason for infection. Catheter had to be removed, and femoral dialysis, that too should not have been done. And finally, we have tunneled catheter AVF failures. This is very common. This is an elective surgery with the highest failure rate. It has a 40% primary failure rate. So please keep in mind that almost half of your fistulas will be failing. So this is what is required when we plan a fistula. And again, this patient again went to different places, and maybe nothing was done in time, and that way we really had a very poor outcome in this patient. In the meantime, I just will take 2 slides on the IDEAL trial. This was a trial done showing whether in early initiation dialysis was better, or we initiate dialysis late. And this was done over, it was very well designed trial, and there were around 828 patients. What I just want to point out is that once we do a delayed start of dialysis, some patients might be off dialysis for as long as 2 years, but for an average of at least 1 year or so, they will be off dialysis. However, there will be no change in outcomes. So there is no requirement of really taking every CKD stage 5 to dialysis. Only those who have symptoms, in them you dialyze. Not in every patient of CKD stage 5. You will not adversely affect the outcomes. So the next patient, we see this is the classical case, the type 2 diabetes patient with a poor control of diabetes, 20 years of diabetes. They have all comorbidities by the time they have they go on to end-stage renal disease. But another very important thing that I want to emphasize is acute kidney injury. We were classically taught that acute kidney injury gets okay, but that is not true. Acute kidney injury has very variable course. A large percentage of people with acute kidney injury will progress to chronic kidney disease. Some of them will go on to end-stage renal disease directly as well. So this is another factor. Then we see that the GFR was rising gradually, and in the meantime, he had developed all complications of the disease as such, CKD5. And then there was the obvious confusion whether to go for PD or HD. I'll just take up two slides at the end about what are the various modalities. So the modalities of dialysis are one, hemodialysis, that we are doing day in and day out. So we need an AV fistula, that is what is to be preferred. AV fistula is made, and we require a dialysis machine, and it's done through that. Peritoneal dialysis is a very simple process. It does not require any special equipment. It can be done at the home of the patient, and it is just fluid exchange through the peritoneal cavity. And finally, the renal transplant, in which donor places a new kidney, which is attached to the iliac vessels there, and which is used that way. So choice of modality is not really very good. It's like a choice between how do you want to die, which of them do you like, the sword, the hang, or the getting shot. So the pros and cons of hemodialysis are, hemodialysis is widely available. The cost is around 15,000 to 20,000 rupees a month in cheaper centers. We have good volume control and limited time expenditure is required. Whereas the cons are very poor quality of life. It is hospital-based. There are vascular access problems, which we saw in both of the patients. There are blood-borne infections. There is usually poor compliance. There is rapid loss of the residual renal function. The patients, they have outputs of 1 liter when they begin dialysis. Within 6 months, the output goes down to 500 ml, and then they have no output after a short duration of time. It is very non-physiological, and we need to restrict water in all of them. They really scold us, like, I don't want to carry on with this life anymore. It's that bad. Peritoneal dialysis is a home-based therapy. It is a continuous ongoing process, so it is rather a softer kind of dialysis, so to say. There is relative preservation of residual renal function. We get also some extra calories from dextrose, and usually they have better compliance. They are the more motivated patients. However, the cons are the peritoneal membrane is very variable, so we never know how it will react in that particular person. Someone might not have any ultrafiltration. The other issue is the catheter, the inner tip is open, it's mobile, it can migrate anywhere. You can have failure of the catheter, which is placed in the abdomen. Peritonitis rate is of course there, and there is high protein requirement. Also, it is more expensive. It costs around 22,000 rupees a month for the regular prescription, just for dialysis itself. Finally, we have renal transplant. That is the best. We have restoration of all functions of the kidney. We have better quality of life and lower cost. On the long-term basis, around 10,000 rupees a month is the cost. However, it has the highest short-term cost, and the biggest issue is having a live donor. Cadaveric programs are, so to say, non-existent in this country. So we have just live donors, and that too, it's a problem. And we have immunosuppression as well that has to be given lifelong. However, there are large number of drugs these patients have to take, lots of side effects of these drugs, so it's not really that good a life as well. So we see, this is one chart I really wanted to show to you. A person between 1 and 19 years of age has, in a general population, a life expectancy of 69 years. Whereas, if he gets a transplant, that life expectancy comes down to just 29 years. This continues throughout. On dialysis, both forms of dialysis, peritoneal dialysis as well as hemodialysis, have the same survival, no advantage in survival. They will just be living for 17 years. So, we see one thing. With time, with the younger age group, they will gain larger number of years if we transplant them. Yet, the survival is even less than half of what would have happened if they had not developed chronic kidney disease, if they had not developed end-stage renal disease. This is to say that even transplant as a modality is not something that is really very out of the world. It is very suboptimal at this present day and age. Now let's come back to the patient. This patient had gradual rise in creatinine, and now a fistula was made. So, but in spite of the fistula being made, it did not work because there was non-development of the AVF segment. What had happened is branching veins had developed, which were then later cut off, they were revised. And this person could be initiated on dialysis electively. He never had a hospital admission in the last 2.5 years or 3 years that we have been following up. And again, we see with the problem with hemodialysis. He has gradual reduction in renal function, requiring 3 times weekly dialysis now for the last 2 months. However, he is doing well currently. But along with all these things, he was fighting for dialysis, he was getting a fistula made. But along with this, there was another big burden, and that is of medications. We fill them with medications. We give them so many medications. Unfortunately, they have to take antihypertensives, diuretics, phosphate binders, antiemetics, antiplatelets, iron, some water-soluble vitamins, vitamin D, maybe many of them will require calcium, anti-hyperuricemic drugs, erythropoietins. This is in addition to the basic comorbidities. So diabetes would not heal itself, so they would require medicines for diabetes. He has had a bypass, so he would require medicine for his cardiac medicines as well. So there are large number of medicines that these persons have to take. So it really gives us a very poor quality of life. But what do we hope for the future? The future, we hope to have cadaveric transplant programs. That is helpful because we will never be able to do live donor transplants to the extent that is required. Cadaveric transplant programs have to come up. Secondly, home-based dialysis, maybe portable dialysis machines, and this is something that is maybe in the next future, over the next 5 to 10 years we would have it. We'd be having smaller, more portable physiologic dialysis machines which would be wearable. So wearable is the first step. The next step would be implanting it into the patient when it would be a bio-artificial kidney. So this is what we expect in the future. However, to conclude, treatment of end-stage renal disease remains suboptimal. There is a very high mortality rate because of large number of issues. However, it is just planning and proper patient education that would help us in maybe improving the outcomes. Renal transplant remains among the various modalities, the option of choice for management of end-stage renal disease. That's all. Thank you.